So, with the thought process, we serve all the banks, mainly public sector banks in India. And with the thought process, the takeaway is the self-service convenience are yet to be availed for the remaining 400 villages, and the story of ATM will continue to play a stronger role in the financial inclusion with the Government of India schemes. Thank you. Any questions? Any questions? Yeah, thanks.
Mr. Mahapatra had already covered the leadership, you know, in digital age, and my friend Saurabh has already covered the organization structure. Let me roll up my sleeves and come down to what needs to be done. And as CIOs, you know, we are all, most of us are CIOs here, and there's a task to be done. The leadership decides, you know, the vision of the company or, you know, the digital challenge which is there today and where you want to take the organization. You construct the organization in a structure where it is conducive for you to go. But still, as IT leaders or CIOs, we have a task to do. We need to do a job, right? So just before I start, these are all personal views, right? I put it saying they're not representative of the company. And it's for this particular forum. Some of it may look prescriptive, but it is not. It's completely a thought which I'm sharing, which is up to you. Whether you think it's valuable, please take it. Otherwise, please give me your feedback. I'm more open to feedback and learning from you and also sharing my thoughts. So it's almost like a validation of thoughts. So various different things that we as CIOs, I'm talking from a CIO perspective, as we hear, basically say that digitalization is a trendy word, and if you use the terms like digitization, you know, it kind of sound primitive. And to share one thing, in the organization, when we started the digital journey, the entire organization was actually calling it the digitization team. And someone had to really correct them, saying that, okay, you know what? There's a difference between digitization and digitalization. Someone had to actually explain that particular bit. I know you all know what is the difference, so I'm not repeating that. Someone also said the CIO is dead at the age of the CDO. And here not the data officer, basically saying that the digital officer. So there was a concept which came in basically saying that there will be a chief digital officer who is going to drive the digital initiative in an organization. Some of the analysts said that that would be a position which will come in and will become more important. Someone said that the CMO will hold a larger IT budget than the CIO himself. We also heard that, you know, the difference between this, which I already mentioned, and if you're not doing anything digital, you're --, because basically it's saying that you're not relevant anymore, or you're not good enough for the leadership position right now. How do you traverse all of these? So to understand that, I just went into a little bit of history of when we started hearing this term digital. And before this, you know, the Gartners of the world or the analysts started talking of nexus of forces and the changing paradigm and, you know, technology taking over business and stuff like that. So when I looked at the history, I see how people have also evolved in this digital world. So I thought, let me just take you back a couple of years, not more than, you know, few months actually. When you count it, it's like, this is not very old, right? So the first thing that I saw was people, as soon as they said, we want to go digital, they said, let's jazz it up. Let's change the look and feel. So work on the website. The first project, even in our organization that started, was say, let's revamp the website, right? Let's take something to mobile. Is that going digital? The question is, sometimes you jazz it up, change the look and feel, sometimes very subtle. Sometimes it can be a little outrageous, sometimes hideous, and sometimes you add a little bit of nice look and feel. But like modifying a car, are you actually modifying an organization? This is a question that you need to ask. Like in these examples that are there, the engine is the same. The performance capability of the car is the same, but you change the look and feel of that particular car. Right? Now, what is the danger? If you do not empower the backend, if you do not power the capabilities of the organization to give that particular feeling, you might actually stall the whole thing. And we have seen some cases where people have gone to the mobile, where people have enabled, you know, the online channels, but the backend was becoming a bottleneck and not able to take care of those loads, was not capable of processing those requests which are coming in, which are directly coming from the customers. Then we have the next wave of digital initiatives, even in the BFSI segment, which is something similar to what we have, like a navigation system which assists the driver. So these are all assisting tools that we are giving. So like a driver gets an assistance of the route map, or gets all the sensor information, Tyrtronics, you know. So these are all initiatives that we have seen which help productivity, which helps human decision making, right? Which is basically data. We have data coming from different sources. We bring in all the data together, put it into a context. We give it to the driver and say, okay, now you are capable of making a better decision. And all productivity enhancing tools that we have seen, whether it is the point of sale system in most of the insurance companies that we see, or in the banks, or you know, the lead management systems, or point of sale, or the application processing, or you know, self-service tools for the frontline, most of it will be in this category. So, and this is one category which is becoming a must-have. You will not buy a car which doesn't have an ABS, which doesn't have these features, because these, you got habituated to these. And if you don't have this, you'll not probably get the customers, or you'll not have the same level of efficiencies in the organization. This is a must-have. It's like a non-negotiable for you to do. So any digital initiative, you're doing this. And you can map it to your own organizations. I'm not an expert in banking or, you know, in your domain, but you can kind of correlate that. Then we have the next level where you have this taking over humans, where they can go wrong. Like, for example, the parking assist feature in the car, or an ESP, which basically takes control of you if you are drifting away and going to spin off the road, or when a driver is fatigued and he is going to sleep, you know, there's an alert system, or the various sensor-based thing which basically says lane diversion and stuff like that. So these are areas where digital is taking over from a human wherever the human can go wrong. I'll give you an example from insurance. Automated underwriting, for example, or automated fraud detection, you know, algorithms. This is where cognitive comes into play. You have to think of where cognitive computing or artificial intelligence can actually take over from the human in exception scenarios, do a task, or you can flip it around, do the task in the normal form, and give it back to the human for exception, right? You have different use cases for each of these cases. So that is the third level of digital which I'm seeing similar to this, which is there in the BFSI segment. And each one of us have to also think from an organizational perspective what we have in that. Next is where you're completely replacing a human. And like in the driverless cab case, you're replacing the complete cab design. This will probably, you know, challenge Uber. And this is where we are completely seeing some of the activities which are either operational activities or intelligence-based activities where the human can completely be replaced. We have to see that what is happening in our organization and which are the areas where we can do this as well. Or we can think of the entire ecosystem. This is an example where the car decides almost everything. Basically, plans your trip, plans your route, checks itself, you know, it integrates with, let's say, a bookmytable.com to say, if I'm going to a service, I will get you a nice restaurant to spend time for that particular bit. But what I want to tell in this slide is to say that the ecosystem for an organization is becoming more and more important, and the digitalization initiative is not just limited to your organization. When I say that, For me, it's important that my aggregators and my partners are digitally connected with me, and the business processes for the journey which is there, of whether the customer or, you know, even my partners or employees, it's going beyond the organization's boundaries. So how do I tie up with them? How do I tie up not just with my partners, but with other industry bodies? For example, you're tying up with Aadhaar for integration. Aadhaar is not part of your organization, but it's in the ecosystem, right, for eKYC. So you have to identify your ecosystem and how you leverage the power of the ecosystem for the benefit of your organization becomes very important. So that is the next level. So what exactly is going digital? Is it making everything web and mobile facing? Or is it about the SMAC that Mr. Mahapatra mentioned, which is basically cloud, mobile, big data, and social? Or is it about IoT and telematics? We all kind of sometimes take, you know, there's a vision, but sometimes we take a very myopic view of saying that, okay, we do one initiative here, one initiative there, and that's digital. Or I set up a digital branch, or I set up a mobile application, and I've gone digital. So we kind of do one of these projects. A lot of companies do this. And the idea is, it's not just one-off initiative, it's a complete change in the way we do digital. So it's about focusing on experience. And here, experience is for everyone, it's not just the customer. So the customer, the workforce, the partners, the ecosystem. It's about continuous improvement. It's about adding new capabilities that go beyond the human limits. It's about ease of doing business. It's about exploiting the ecosystem. It's about enhancing decision-making capabilities. It is about leveraging all possibilities to maximize business value. Net-net, it is basically saying you have to be aware of the entire technological advancements that are happening around in the world and try to see how you can achieve all the above using those. So what can we do? I'm just sharing some thoughts which I have. You can always question them, you can always see. What I first saw was to see where do we exactly stand and what kind of IT organizations are there, or majority of the IT organizations are there in organizations. There are some IT organizations which are still at the level of the support guys, the order takers. The next level is the solution enabler, the guys who partner with business. They document the business needs and recommend solutions. Then we have the next guys who are like internal business consultants who proactively recommend solutions to the business and wait for the business to agree and then implement. And then you have the strategic leaders type of the IT leadership or the IT organization, which basically are evangelists of solutions, evangelists of digital transformation, and they are the transformers for the company, sorry. What we need to do is to be honest to ourselves. We don't need to tell others, or you don't need to, like, you know, it's not an advertisement for something. It's basically saying that when we are doing this activity, we have to be honest to ourselves, where do we stand? And you cannot be a solution provider if you are firefighting every day. You cannot be a transformer if you're worried saying that, you know, my systems will go down, or there is one project for which, you know, business user is crying, or I need to do this automation because he's asking, and, you know, those operational things, what worried the CIO. You cannot be a transformational digital leader if you're operationally completely tied up. You will not have the bandwidth to think that. But it is important to know that we have to traverse this particular path. Without that, whatever the organization wants to do, there would be someone else who is going to be leading that initiative and not the CIO. So the CIO has to come up the curve to be a digital leader. He needs to go through this path. He needs to be at the top. He needs to be a transformer. What we need to do after knowing where we stand is to say where we stand vis-a-vis the world. It's basically to say where do I stand in my automation index? It's also very important. If you're not automated, what are you going to digitize? You know, put it to the digital world. Where do I stand in the digital landscape itself to benchmark what all are the various technological advancements in the digital world, and where do I stand? Have we done something? Have we not done something? Is to evaluate, saying what is relevant to me, what is not relevant to me, how many people have done what. It's basically saying what are my peers doing, what are my competition doing, what are other industries doing. Also to benchmark on technology. So benchmarking is very important. I think we all need to do this. The next one is to see where does my architecture stand. And I give a lot of emphasis to the architecture. Now earlier it used to be an enterprise architecture and IT architecture. Now I call it the digital architecture. And if you see, similar to the previous one of benchmarking, there are stages of the architecture maturity within an organization. A lot of organizations you would see would somewhere be in the business silos. What Saurav also mentioned about the organization structures and various silos, right? You can actually create an organization with digital silos now. While you might think that you are business modular and your web services enabled, and suddenly you can do all this digital stuff by having a set of web services or a web services library, you might actually be in this siloed business still. So this is a slide that's not new. This is a slide that I picked up, you know, back in 2004 or 5. And this is how I've personally tracked the progress of the various initiatives within the organization and seen how the growth was. And we took, you know, you can see the number of years it took for us to migrate from one to the other to the other. So how do you migrate that? I've written some things, basically working around the legacy, standardizing technologies, removing redundancies, creating a SOA architecture. Basically, if you are in the business modularity, the chances are that your organization level agility is high. So when we talk of these two modes, when you talk of these agile developments required or the digital initiatives and requiring this whole demand of fast-paced execution of projects. If you are at this level, your life will be much easier. But to reach that level, there's a lot of homework. You cannot directly jump in and say that we can be business modular. You're going to go through the standardizing of technology. You can't be running multiple different, you know, technology platforms. You can still have platforms, but they need to be optimized, right? And they need to be doing specific tasks or specific specialist tasks to reach here. I hope I made my point this one. I can take questions on this later. Then is to look at the architecture pillars. This also has not changed. These are fundamentals of technology, almost every one of you know. But there are certain components which have got added in each of these. You get to keep evolving the architecture also in lines with the digital architecture. So automation remains, but in automation, you probably have apps. Now, I'm not saying applications. I'm basically saying apps. And bit of mobility added to that particular bit. So I've separated the apps from applications. Because that's how we have seen the world. You know, it started off with singular apps. It went into some client-server apps. It went into ERP. Then came to the SOA-based different stuff. And now we are back to the app world, individual apps. But then those are integrated at back end to all the other systems which are there. Right? So that's where this gets added, mobility gets added, SOA is always there. EDI gets added as an important component to the integration architecture. What is EDI? It's external data interface or external data interchange. You can call it either of there. It's basically to say that, am I ready to integrate with my external partners or ecosystem? So evaluate your we have to evaluate our integration architecture to see how well are we prepared to integrate with the ecosystem. Because if you can't integrate with the ecosystem, the first one that I mentioned earlier, you know, you'll be working in a silo, and no organization can afford to work in a silo or a cut-off way than the ecosystem today. That's a fact. Our business leaders are asking us to go out and reach out and leverage our partners' capabilities and complement that to bring value to the organization. So do you have an EDI in your integration architecture? That's a very important stuff. The remaining thing that yesterday we heard about the data consistency and integrity and stuff, all that remains same. There's no change in that particular, the importance level of those. Those are like hygiene stuff. So if you don't have the hygiene, you can't do anything, right? If you're not healthy, you can't go and perform, simple. So it's like the hygiene factor, the health of the organization, health of the IT organization is the bottom part. Even in the information architecture, there are some things that got added. Like earlier, we used to say the data warehouse or ODS and stuff like that. Now you have a new thing called as big data. But the challenge is to find the use cases of big data and the data sources of the big data. And each organization has to see. It's not about saying, I will put up a Hadoop cluster or a grid architecture and I'm done. I have big data. So I have petabytes of data which is coming into a Hadoop cluster, whether it is structured or unstructured. You know, it's just a data store. What do you do with that data store? So data science or data scientists, and more importantly is the algorithms. You know, the importance to the algorithms is much more, and that is where the factor for, like, the key success factor will be. The factor for victory will be in that algorithm. And algorithms are the ones which will differentiate organization to organization. It is not probably about the number of analysts or data scientists you have. It's about those algorithms that these guys will come out with, which will give you this insight, which will give you this power to leverage data for business benefit. So what is that business benefit that you want to drive will be the most important question for driving this particular bit. And information architecture needs to be ready for that. You need to have the tools and techniques. You need to have the data sources prepared. So that is hygiene. So in this, the hygiene is saying that I need to have a Hadoop cluster to get the data which comes in, right? But that's not the end of it. That's what my limited point is. Having a Hadoop cluster is not the end of it. Having a big data store is not the end of it. Having licenses to, let's say, ClickView, ClickSense, the BO tools, the various BI tools or analytical tools is not the end of it. I implement it, it's nice, it's a good server, you know. It gives me a good dashboard, I can click and drag and drop, but what? Right. So it's about the algorithm, it's about how you use that. Another important thing which is coming is analytics on the fly. So we have heard of analytics. It's like the data scientists will do the analytics. They'll take a hypothesis and give it to you. What is analytics on the fly? Analytics on the fly is almost like when I'm on the ground, that is when I get the information that I need at that particular point in time. I'll give you an insurance example. When I am going to pitch to a customer, if my system can throw me a pre-approved sum assured for which I don't need to collect any documents, and I can issue the policy right there, Praveen asked this, right? Then I have a case. If Praveen applies for a policy and the premium for his age and term and everything comes to a level where he doesn't like it, or he has to undergo a medical test which he's not comfortable with, can I use analytics on the fly to generate a revised quote to do a counter offer? So counter offer is an analytics on the fly output to say, you know what, just reduce 5,000 rupees from your premium and corresponding sum assured and you don't have to go for a medical. Right. These are the use cases of analytics on the fly. That's becoming more and more important today. So we have to figure out what do we do with algorithms and the analytics on the fly using the hygiene which is at the bottom. As far as infrastructure is concerned, I think all the CTOs will definitely be, you know, this is like the core of IT. Everyone started with that particular bit. But some things get added there also, which is variability, which is agility. Now, what is agility in infrastructure, right? You need agility. I mean, it was not heard of. You had long cycles of purchase and stuff like that. But with the cloud coming in, with various different models of virtualization and everything, you can still do that. So you have to evaluate that bit also. So you need to tell your CTO, you need to tell your infrastructure head, you know what, digital does not just mean for the application world or the analytics world, it is also for you, right? Then we have to prepare for the challenge of parallelism. When I say parallelism, Mr. Mahapatra already mentioned this, is about the two-speed IT or the bimodal IT, right? Which is basically to say that, you know, mode one is keeping that hygiene clear. All the systems of record, we are governed. And one of my friends, I will not name them, and like we all closed this financial year, we have, you know, to establish the authenticity of that book that we write and the balance sheet, which comes out of the systems that we maintain. We have to ensure that the governance is very, very strong, right? Now, governance means you have to follow the waterfall method, typically. Everything needs to be documented. Everything needs to be signed off. Everything needs to be maker checker done. Everything needs to be verified. Everything needs to be ensured that data integrity is at the topmost quality, right? So that is mode one. We cannot, on the expense of digital, compromise on data integrity, as simple as that. That means the core banking system or the core insurance system, you cannot just go on and say, I want to be agile, I will do a change every day or do a change every week, you know. I will not do change management, I will just do quick tweaks. You can't do that. Because if you do that, you know, the auditors or the regulatory body will come back and say that, you know, I don't trust the balance sheet that you're generating out of the system. It's not trustworthy. You know, there could be flaws in the financial reporting that you're doing. So we cannot do that. So then, how do we meet this agility? So we have to bifurcate. We, as IT leaders, have to bifurcate systems basis criticality. Simple. From a financial perspective or from a digital enabler perspective. Now within this, one thing we can never compromise is this, security. We want to do fast changes, but if you are not secure, you know, or you don't do security testing before you do a release of the website or a mobile application, and here we are talking of, at least for us, we are BFSI, we are not, you know, a startup where the stakes are low. You know, they can afford to go out of business. We can't. We can't risk our reputation. So there's a level of caution that need to be taken in the system of innovation and the mode two. You may compromise on the SDLC cycle. You don't need to do the waterfall. It's fair enough. Don't do the waterfall. Right? We can do the agile methods, but still mitigate the risks attached to what comes with agility. Just that bit that needs to be taken care of in the mode two. Oops. Yeah, sorry. The other thing is to say the CIO needs to be effective in the organization, right? Now, on the other slide of the growth of the IT organization, I mentioned saying that the CIO needs to be a transformer or a transformational leader. What the analysts are saying, and this is a slide which has been inspired and taken from Gartner, basically says that if a CIO has at least one additional business role, one additional business role at least, you have a better chance to succeed in the digital journey. Because you're influencing power. You're not an order taker anymore. You're basically a business leader. You think like a business. You contribute to business, and you can talk to your peers like a peer. Normally, like they say, that it blame it on the weatherman. You know, so IT is typically the last one to take the blame, right? Whether it is operations, it did not work because my systems were not performing, right? To avoid all of that. So either take, and this is what the organization, I don't know how many CIOs will be able to influence this directly, but it's a message to the organization and the organization structures and the leaders of the board. Say CIO as a COO, we have seen a lot of these cases where the CIO is the COO. It's just the natural progression because technology, business process goes together. CIO as the chief digital officer makes it easy because then he understands the digital and he understands technology. He can marry those two together, and then he can be an evangelist to the various business functions and go and, you know, sell those concepts and ideas and drive them. CIO as a CMO for new products and services, so you can align this whole digital with the product and services, you know, arm of this of their business. So make more products conducive to the digital world. Or the strategy officer, or in some cases where he's a board member. That's what helps you become more effective in the organization. And that's key to success. If you're just doing IT, even if you're reporting to the CEO, you know what challenges you would face. We all have gone through this. So every CIO needs to be a bimodal CIO today. You need to have two modes. On one hand is the audit compliance regulation. On the other hand is the digital and the agility. So you are somewhere in between, you know, balancing it. And you need to be bimodal to be able to do that. How did we apply this learning? Now we benchmarked and stuff like that. So just to take an example, we looked at the funnel, the sales funnel. One of the objectives was to ensure that we want to increase the sale. So when I started studying the sales process or funnel, I basically realized that there is a conversion ratio, which is the slope of the funnel in different stages going through. So what can we do? So we said, okay, at that reach, which is the available market source, you can't see that here because of the slide. Available market source, can we do a demand generation initiative? The next level, can we do a campaign management initiative? We can do a lead management initiative or the point of sale on the go, or the digital backend, wherein we created the entire automated stuff. To give you an example of the digital backend, for the scale of operations of ICICI Prudential, I can give you this particular thing, saying that 11,000 insurance policies application processed by operations team. It was almost saying that if you look at a traditional insurance organization, you need hundreds of people. But in iPro, because of the automation that we have done, we are processing it with 10 internal staff and 40 outsourced data entry operators, and about 26 to 40 underwriters. That is because a lot of it is automated. A lot of it is document verification is not through an eyeball, it's through an OCR. So things like that. And we benchmarked a lot of stuff from the Gartner's hype cycle model and various different benchmarking exercises that we did to choose all of these initiatives to do to ensure that this funnel, the slope of each of these stages of funnel improve. The next is just the last slide, pre-last slide.
Hello?
Yeah. Like previously said, incremental improvements will not give you the benefits. It is the business process re-engineering or redesign or completely thinking lateral to come out of the box and think out of the box to look at a completely new way of doing things, which is important. That's what will give you higher improvement. So we have to continuously look at this. This is a very important slide. One thing that we took internally was saying that we don't want to do operations by norm. We want to do operations only by exception. So the rest of it has to be technical. The rest of it has to be automated. The rest of it, it needs to be completely auto and no manual touch. So basically, eliminating flab and eliminating work. So it's not about BPM anymore or a workflow anymore. It's about eliminating work. So the final slide about key learnings. Digital is not an IT initiative in isolation. It's a transformation which is enterprise-wide, already spoken. It needs to be driven from top, and adoption has to be from the bottom. These are the two key things, you know. While it goes, the drive has to grow, go downwards, and adoption has to go both ways, like all through. Every function is a digital function, like Saurabh mentioned, has to be digitally awakened, and every business head needs to be a chief digital officer. You don't need a separate designation as a chief digital officer. Every function head himself has to become that. And CIO needs to be a CDO's ally and stay one step ahead. You're better in technology, so you can be better in digital know-how as well. Project governance and PMO become even more important. And creating an environment conducive to experimentation is a must-have. These are all things which have been spoken in the previous presentations. I don't need to repeat that. Thank you. Any questions? Yes, Praveen.
Thanks, Deepak. It's a nice insight of what is happening in digital world. Two things you mentioned about, you know, one is about analytics on the fly. The observations, you know, the collection of data, the quality of data collection is not that good because of most of the organizations are having old data and new systems are not that sound to collect robust data to do the analytics part. We do have, you know, just mentioning about that analytics on fly, we do have demo on our booth, you know, you can have a look of that. We have built some framework on that, analytics on fly. Second, it's a question to you. I'm a customer, I'm not talking as an IT guy or entrepreneur. I'm a customer of insurance companies. I don't care about what is compliance there because I have options. In today's world of Bitcoin and Paytm, the response time, resolution time is very fast. I don't care what insurance companies are having their compliance. I want fastest resolution time. I want fastest response time. So how you feel that the compliance parts or regulators to ease their policies on, you know, onboarding of the customer, onboarding of their policies?
See, I'll put it this way, that I don't think regulation comes into the way of enabling that. You know, today, and we're working on one of the initiatives and probably go live in a couple of months, where an agent comes to you and says a life insurance policy. Traditionally, life insurance policy cycle time is at least 7 to 15 days. It used to be. Today, ICICI Pru is able to issue about 90% of the policies within one hour of receiving that e-application form. And 95% plus of our applications are e-forms as of date today. Now, what is needed for issuance, I take an issuance example, some of the insurance company people are here, is basically payment, application form, underwriting decision, and and KYC. These are the four things which are required, like document KYC. All of these can be automated. You have an e-app form, you have an e-pay option, or the e-payment options, automated underwriting, and the last one is eKYC, which is through Aadhaar integration or whatever, right? So you're ready to issue. Unless there's a medical underwriting test that the customer has to take, which is a longer process. So if it is under the STP limits, you can issue it instantaneously. And except for that particular West signature also, you know, there are methods you can do that, and the regulator actually has allowed this, which is basically saying that you can take a signature on the tab from the customer and authenticate that signature using an OTP. Right, so there are methods like that, and currently we are issuing policies within less than 1 hour for the STP cases, and within 15 minutes is the target, which will happen in the next couple of months. And as for the service is concerned, more and more things are put into self-service or assisted service, or helping any agent to come and service you using a authentication of OTP with the customer. So we're doing that.
Thank you. I know you are short of time. I need 1 minute more. My example, my personal example, you know my lifestyle. You know, I most of the times I'm in flight. My policy lapse, you know, the due date is around 6 or 7 days. And I was not in India, and they want my medical reports and everything in India. And if I'm not fulfilling that date, my policy is getting lapsed. You know, because again, I have to go the process and do all my renewals and everything, because that's my personal experience. And just I simply changed my policy. I left that company and went for other policy.
Say if you
and
keep
my example for you.
If you keep paying premium, you don't need to go for a medical again. Right? Medical
40.
Is required only
after 40.
Yeah, yeah. So it's only at the time of issuance and not at the time of renewal premium. You don't need to pay the go for this thing unless you lapse and come and reinstate. We can take it offline. I don't think it requires this entire forum to discuss on transactions. But the thing is, from a digital standpoint, I'm saying that all of these transactions can be self-service or assisted service, right? So we'll take it.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Get it down to the luggage room. If you choose to go up to your room and maybe pack a little, or if you choose to get your own bags, you can do that as well. Coffee is served outside. We'll take a break for the next 20 minutes. Traditional to digital bank assurance. I request Mr. Sandeep Chakraborty, the Senior Vice President, IT PMO and Digital Marketing of Bharati AXA General Insurance, to come onto the stage.
Hello, everybody. So we actually have heard a lot about technologies, because this mainly is a CIO forum, but this the topic that I have chosen is more on a very specialized kind of a thing, that is bank assurance. So I belong from a general insurance industry. I look after the technology there, and so I actually have lot of chance to see how exactly the bank assurance process happens in a general insurance industry. So what actually current stage, and I'm actually, what I'm trying to tell you, it may not be true for lot banks where they are digitally very savvy and all, but normally what I have come across is banks actually sell insurance products, and the selling stops there. Once the sell happens, then the entire document moves many a times physically to the insurance company. And what happens is the customer experience shifts. Because in a general insurance industry, you will find the process is a bit different from life, because in general insurance, what happens is customer actually touch bases an insurance company multiple times during a year. because policy is for 1 year. During the policy, first is the customer onboarding and the policy issuance. After that, there may be endorsements, the policy modifications. Suppose you are buying a home insurance and then you are bringing new gadgets in your house, then those are also need to be insured. So those are called endorsements. So at that point of time, there is a customer touch base with insurance company. And then within the year, there may be a loss, a claim. And claim can be successive also. So there can be a lot of claims also. So during that time also, the customer needs to interact with an insurance company. So during the entire period, what I have seen is, if the policy has been sold and the experience has been pretty good for a customer, and subsequently, when this customer is handed over to the insurance company, there is a big shift. Second point I just want to put here is in bank assurance, in general insurance, what we have seen is there are two types of policies. One is for loans and disbursement. The insurance comes pretty automatically. Whoever is getting a loan, at that point of time, the insurance is a must that needs to be attached. So at that point of time, the customer is in the mindset of loans or getting the loans through. At that point of time, he doesn't mind the attachment, which is an insurance. So this is an area where the business comes pretty easy. But the other part is the retail insurance, where the banks need to touch base with the customers to sell the policy, or it is a, because as all already we know that they need to convince the customer to sell the policies. So in these two scenarios, what I am actually more emphasizing on the retail piece of it, because the commercial piece on loans and disbursement, however, whatever is the process, because that's an easy money for an insurance company also, so that is perfectly okay. But on the retail piece, there are a lot of new changes that are coming. There is a digital disruption. There are new players coming, like payment banks, fintechs, web aggregators. So, and that retail is a big money. So this is the place where actually I want my presentation, that how can there be a shift from a traditional bank assurance to a digital bank assurance. So first part is, the value drivers of a bank assurance between an insurance company and a bank, these are the one. Because for bank also, they look out for a stable alternate source of earning in the form of non-traditional and fee-based source of income. Because so far as the core banking operation is concerned, many a times it is a very tight kind of a rope that they are working in. And for insurers, If you compare for the entire insurance industry, there are 100,000 agents. So if an insurer gets a ready-built 80,000 bank branches across the industry, then actually it's a symbiotic relation. Because for insurance companies also, they require a very solid distribution platform. So that is what they get in banks. So that's why this bank assurance normally is a very favored piece for both banks as well as for insurance company. And because in European countries and all, and especially in France, the bank assurance penetration is as high as 60 to 65%. And so first is in the distribution model, the value drivers are very, very solid for both the partners. Second one is, in Indian context, when this bank assurance came in its form, there was a phenomenal growth. Because in 2009, the total premium that has been garnered through bank assurance was more than 22,000 crores. So just imagine the fees is in the range of 3,000 crores for the banks. And at the same time, the benefit is insurance companies are getting 22,000 crores. And that means the penetration or the market share of the insurance companies as a whole in India from bank assurance was as high as 7-7.5%. But that's not enough, because the benchmark is at the range of 60-65% across world. So what has happened is from 2009 to 2015, 15 and all, over the time we are seeing that they are reaching a plateau. Because bank, as I have told you, the bank premium is coming in two ways. One is retail and one is commercial. Commercial means the industry as a whole has to progress so that they can actually insure more and more. The sum insured will be high, the premium will be high and all. So that is one part. The second part is the retail piece. On the retail piece, actually, there are huge amount of competitions also in this market now. So which actually is being felt by both insurance and banks also. So on that piece, if the business process remains pretty non-digital kind, I think it will remain in this plateau for some time. So that is the place where actually the digital intervention is must. So I have already talked about the strength is basically insurance company utilize the physical infrastructure of the banks, because every bank, then there will be an insurance counter. So virtually insurance companies are there in all the branches. And another thing is there are, especially, I mean, because from general insurance I know very well, there are a lot of products like home insurance, which is a back-to-back product for a loan, home loan. So those are basically, those are logical product extension that actually goes hand in hand for the product piece. And the challenges are, it's not only technology, there are a lot many other things that products, if we don't customize products as per the customers, then what happens is actually we are actually pushing the products. So pushing the products means, so for that, those products normally actually, or the revenue that we get normally goes down over the time. If the product value is not seen by the customers. So what are the digital advantage? Digital advantage is, convenience is it is always on. I mean, technically 24/7. I mean, you can buy products from either bank or from insurance company. Always the experience will be absolutely common, absolutely identical. Secondly, it is always there, and it comes almost free, because it's basically it's applications which can be used across the country. And on access and connectivity, it is location agnostic and device agnostic. Multi-access has got its own meaning here. Is normally the customer's behavior is very varied. So sometimes before buying, they research a lot in the digital platform, but at the same time, at the time of buying, they need a reassurance. So they may come to the bank or to buy it offline, or other way around, they research offline and go online. So in the multi-access, what happens is there has to be the uniformity of the data everywhere, so that the customer can do this multi-access kind of a research and product buying and sales and services at any point of time without any distortion in his services. And what are the digital expectations? One is data on demand. The product should be very, very simple. I mean, so that it can be actually understood by anybody, because currently there is a notion that insurance products are pretty complex. There are always some do's and don'ts, which actually the customer feels that it actually suddenly comes up at the time of claims. So that's why the product should be very, very simple. So that means the product customization for the banks should be taken into account. And whatever is the other mode of sales or servicing process, there should be some sort of it should not be a direction that, okay, you have to click this and ultimately you have to go this way and that way. There should be some sort of a dialogue also, that suppose a customer stops somewhere, that where exactly, what exactly he needs to do, that should actually come very intuitively. And the complaint resolution should be faster, and it should be multi-service. So on this advantage, what happens is, if we are talking about retail, we are talking about mass, we are talking about reducing the cost. So reduction of cost can only come if those processes are not touched in multiple stages by human resources. So technology can help a lot in this. So who are the digital customers? Digital customers are basically, they are better informed. They are highly demanding, because if we see currently every company, they are all working on digital. We are also into B2Cs and so many things. You will find that their expectations are soaring high. So they are very demanding. And also they can jump channels at any point of time. So what that means is they can do anything. So for that part, bank and insurance should actually make their platform so seamless that the customer should not have a distortion in any of the services. So they can jump channels, because suppose we feel that, okay, we make a process that, okay, first the customer will research online, so we have given the product brochures and online. After that, we expect that the customer will come to the relationship manager of the insurance company who is sitting in a bank and all. It may not be possible, because the customer might say, okay, now I know it, can I go online only? So research and online purchase in an online mode. Secondly, demand for online services, most personalized service. So this is one thing which is actually lagging. I think it is lagging throughout, especially in general insurance. As I have told you, there are multiple touch points for a customer during the entire policy life cycle. So at that point of time, what is happening is many a times, the moment the sale has happened, actually, we feel happy. After that, the customer is left to, or maybe surreptitiously transferred to the insurance company. And after that, the next interactions happens through a long queue in the call center, or maybe a pretty, non-digital mode. So the thing is the online services, so which means the customer should be in a position to claim online, should see his claims positions online, should be in a position to ask for modification in the policies online, and at the same time should have a clear-cut turnaround time for his demands to be met by these interactions. And also we have seen his demand is not only for the younger generation, that 35 years and whatever we are talking about. Demand is all across ages, because the notion of demand is different, but definitely digital demand is everywhere. Can we visit the strategies? So this strategy is currently how the bank assurance models are working. We need to actually revisit the strategy, because the first one is the trust. So trust is the current paradigm is the bank brand's relationship manager, they rely on the bank brand. And relationship manager, they leverage the trust of the bank, and because of which a lot of sales are happening. And once again, it's on the retail piece. So digital impacts are, and as the customer research online, trust need to be developed and leveraged online only. So now what is happening is it is basically pretty offline mode, that I like this brand, bank, I have a respect on this brand, and the relationship manager who is stationed in the bank, he is actually getting the sale done. So that actually the entire process need to come into an online mode. Second one is the relationship manager, and it is more relevant for life insurance, because in life insurance normally what happens is there are multiple interactions a customer wants to do, because in general insurance there are a lot of straight through processing policies and other things are available, but in a life normally our relationship manager is the key person. So currently, the relationship manager has a natural bias towards selective products. So products are all told to the relationship manager, and he knows which is the product where he can sell most, and those are pushed. And on the mass market products, suppose we talk about personal accident. Personal accident is a mass market product. So on that part, there is no selling activity. It is basically an order taking kind of a thing. Okay, you opt in and you get a product. So this kind of a attitude or the strategy need to be revisited. And the relationship manager need to be more mobile digitally as well as physically, because all those digital assets and all need to go to them so that they can actually do this more in a more mobile manner. Current products are one size fit for all. We actually have not given much of a thought that what exactly customer wants. And also, there may be the same product can be actually construed differently by a customer, because the same personal accident example, personal accident is actually is a product, but if the same product can be treated like as an offering that, okay, if something happens to you, can we take care of your kids' education for next 20 years? So that becomes another offering. So this kind of a product, I mean, we need to have simple customized products also for the banks. And on the customer service, this is actually the biggest drawback here, that there is little or no emphasis on post-sales closure. Once in a bank, this whatever I'm saying is on the in the bank premises, when the bank assurance retail piece happening, that if there is a post-sale closure happens, then after that, everybody thinks back office is back office. Because after that, if the customer asks, then our tone also change. Okay, why don't you talk to this call center number and log your request. So that entire piece actually there is a huge opportunity. Can we automate that? If we can automate this, then what happens is the customer's experience becomes very, very standardized, because the way he got a rousing welcome at the time of buying of a policy and at the time of claims, it will be matching. So mobile technology provides opportunity for cost effective customer service, and at least so on this part, actually, though it looks to be very simple, this is one of the toughest subject for a synergy between a bank and an insurance company. So some of the digital interventions in bank assurance, these are, I mean, whatever I'm talking about is maybe a midterm strategies, and that too, to grow their wallet on retail and also to withstand the threats that are actually happening from various other things, be it payment banks, because they are also eyeing on all those non-financial, non-risk areas. So one is, first is bank and insurance, as Deepak was earlier saying, it's not just, I mean, we actually have web services and integrate and all. There has to be a proper strategy. And both bank and insurance are BFSI. So they actually have a very, very, what you call, robust, but at the same time, maybe closed core systems and all. So how do we integrate? So for integration, there has to be a proper business case that, okay, this is a long-standing relation. If the relationship is for 1 year, 2 year, nothing is going to happen. The relationship has to be a very, very long-term relationship so that both can invest tangibly and can make this customer experience pretty nice on that. So one is the lead generation, and it is more on life also, that can we have a co-partnership model for lead generation? Suppose we all talk about lead generation models and all, but in this case, actually, it has to be co-partnered. Secondly, analytics has to play a role, and in this piece, it is also one of the toughest area, because who owns the data? And there may be a possibility that, I mean, lot of other complexity will come, but analytics has to play a big role to understand the customer behavior at various different stages. And get the lead to the right person, and the lead management system manages multiple leads, major ROI, cross-sell and upsell. So this is one part. The second part is digital ecosystem. Digital ecosystem, as I have talked about, it should be multi-access. Whatever we build, portals or apps and anything, everything should actually target to the common database or common digital ecosystem. And there should be, for customers, if we have customer apps and customer portals and all, there should be the same thing should be there for advisors also. And so that the advisors are always in a farming as well as hunting mode, which means customers should be amenable to servicing the existing customer and at the same time seek opportunity to get some more revenue out of the same client or new clients through a hunting mode. And last one is cross-sell, upsell opportunities. So their data analysis and range of push-based actions. So that also actually happens from coordination of big data as well as the data that is available between the bank and the insurance company, so that we actually can push right kind of a messages at right time to the existing customers, so that the insurance premium grows up. And timely and appropriate handover to the professional advisors. When we require that, okay, this is not as simple, this requires a advisor's intervention, that has to go through the lead management system. So this is my last slide. So what is happening is, first is who builds and controls technology? All this, actually, I have a feeling that if there is a long-standing relationship and this is understood by both, then actually this kind of questions can be actually answered better. So how long-term are the relationship? How closely banks and insurers are aligned? Who does the selling? How many insurance partners does bank have? Because now current open architecture has also come into the picture. Banks can actually go for multiple insurance partners, and they can utilize insurance company in different segmentation. And how to navigate the security and governance maze. So the thing is, which means that it's not a mere that suppose a bank assurance has happened, then suddenly the technology team is called at the last phase and they say, okay, these are my web services which are available, take it and we start. Cannot happen. Because the policy lifecycle needs to be mapped out and digitized. It should not be that, okay, the buy process has been done and then we are absolutely happy. Because ultimately what will happen is we will come to the same plateau. Nothing will go. And in between, the other competitors who are there in the market, like the Paytms and all, they actually will take the wallet share from this bank assurance part. So this is all about the digital bank assurance. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sandeep Chakraborty. The next topic is paperless technologies, the future of banking. I request Mr. Adil Shetty, the CEO of Bank Bazaar, to come onto the stage.
Very, very interesting work happening in financial services in India today. ICICI Prudential, for example, can generate a policy after doing eKYC up to certain limits instantly and in paperless. If there's one word that defines the consumer digital revolution, for me, that word is paperless. Now, Bank Bazaar over the last 7 years has had a very interesting ringside view into what's happening with paperless. Our mission as a company is to ensure that customers access the right financial product. We always put the customer at the center of everything we do. And our vision is we'd like to be the world's largest marketplace delivering instant financial products. And I'm just going to talk you through in the next 10 minutes on what exactly we bring into the ecosystem. The next slide, please. So who are we? We are India's number one mobile and web marketplace for personal finance products. Last month, we did 9 million visitors who came to the site to research, apply, access, and buy financial products. This number, if I dial back 12 months, was 3 million visitors a month. So in a span of 12 months, we've taken 3 million visitors to 9 million visitors. And even now, there's tremendous headway to grow, as there are over 50 million users who are consuming e-commerce who potentially are trained to consume financial products online. We're the category leaders in online loans, credit card, savings products. We've recently launched insurance, which is scaling well. Our focus has always been paperless, so we've tried to build the entire technology platform that any financial institution needs to deliver paperless. So for example, whether you're talking about a technology like eKYC, eSign, processing net banking statements online so that proof of income, proof of address can be done online, integrating with core banking, integrating with pre-approved. Essentially, we bring a full-service consumer tech platform, which has 9 million visitors coming to it every month, which is now, you know, going to scale double in the current year. And we ensure that financial institutions and manufacturers can offer the best possible product with a paperless experience to those consumers. And because consumers trust us, because they know that in everything we do what's best for the consumer, we're able to build a lifelong relationship wherein sometimes a consumer comes to us for a banking product, sometimes for an investment, sometimes for an insurance product. And that's how the entire model has scaled. Now, there's been a lot of interest in this space. So BankBazaar ourselves are invested in by the world's largest e-commerce company, Amazon. And you know, very soon, we'll be working in partnership with Amazon to take these financial products to the masses. We're also invested in by Fidelity, which is the world's largest public market investor, and also Sequoia. So there's a lot of capital which has come into this space, and essentially these digital tech companies being built up saying, hey, how do we build long-term sustainable systems that drive consumer relationships? And our entire focus, right, is in saying that let's not worry about what is the flavor of the season today, but how do we build a tech platform so that the future as we see it is that you pull out your mobile phone, you might be at home talking to your wife about what mutual fund to invest in. Your car insurance policy might be running out and you want to renew it. Or you realize that you have a bonus and you know you want to put it in some kind of fixed deposit. All these products needs to be delivered to your mobile phone. And all these products need to be made available in a paperless fashion from all providers. So that's the vision that BankBazaar is driving to. Next slide, please. So the traction has been quite tremendous. At last count, we were at about 9 million visitors. It's been a tremendous scale up over the last couple of years, over 8x. We serve, at last count, over 40 million page views in a month. And I think deep within the Indian consumer psyche, right, we find that there are two types of consumers. There are the consumers who go directly to a financial institution, and these are the loyal consumers. So they either go to a branch or an internet site. And there are the consumers who say that amongst the institutions out there, who should I go to? And BankBazaar is more catering to the second kind of consumer. And we find actually on our site that 85% of consumers applying to a financial institution on our platform do not have a prior relationship with that financial institution. So the consumer psyche is, I'm very savvy. I want to know what is the best out there for me. And BankBazaar will always help them access the right product, not for money, but because genuinely we want to build a 20-year relationship with that consumer. So we have, you know, we've been able to scale. In terms of the next slide, please. And what I'd like to do is, you know, rather than talk about the product, I'll just give you an end-to-end 5-minute demo of what the user experience looks like. Interestingly, over 50% of our business is on the mobile phone. So majority of consumption is not on desktop. Majority of consumption is on mobile phone. We know for a fact, based on data trends, right, that 70% of our transactions are going to be through the mobile phone in the next 2 years. So there's a big investment in that delivery system. You know, anytime you get a chance, please pull out your phone, type out Bank Bazaar, and you'll see the kind of seamless, visual, easy-to-use experience, which is delivering 11 categories of financial products today. So we'll just dive straight into a demo, which I want to run through. So, quick 5 minute user experience. So the user comes into the site and we offer 11 financial products. The user says they want to consume a personal loan in this particular case. When we design, right, we want to design for people who can literally use a smartphone and touch and feel to go through the process. The users ask, which city do you live in? Which company do you work for? When they start filling in the company, a Tata BPO is high risk. Tata Consulting is Supercat A. We're able to differentiate between the two company types. The design philosophy is, can we use just touch and feel, right? Graphical user interface. So even someone with limited comfort in English can get through the entire process. And we're finding a lot of that happening with smartphone usage, especially in tier 2 and tier 3. The question now was income. This question says, which bank do you bank with? Because we can make a pre-approved offer available to you. Banks also offer certain discounts based on who you bank with. There's a question saying, how long have you worked in this company? How long have you lived in this city? You know, what is your total work experience? All of this goes into the underwriting decisions that an insurance company or a bank would eventually make on the individual. All of this information at this stage is self-reported, and the user is going through a simple touch and feel graphical process. The site itself is almost like a game. So we've tried to take a simple flat form, which might have 15 fields, but that leads to drop off. And you know, we've made it more visual and more a gamification of what is otherwise a dry question process. And what we find is the results are actually very, very positive. About 25% more people tend to go through the same questions on a gamified model than they would do if they were to see one flat form appear when they come in. Once a user is given all of this information, right, we now have enough data to be able to take an eligibility call saying what kind of product can we offer this particular individual. This is obviously done in partnership with our financial service partners. And obviously, tech on the financial services provider side in India is especially strong. So sometimes it's a web API, sometimes it's you know, an automated decisioning system which they make available to us. We make contact information mandatory. This is a conscious decision that Bank Bazaar has taken. And now a set of offers appear. So from the user's perspective, right, this is actually an exact rate line quote. They can actually get a provisional approval on this item at the end of a 5 minute experience. We show them the exact interest rate, 13.49%, so not between 13 and 14%, it is 13.49%. The processing fee is 1618. It's down to the exact second decimal point. The user also has a lot of e-commerce bells and whistles thrown in. You know, there's a voucher from an e-commerce site, there's a recharge coupon, there's a discount if they were to buy furniture along with this home. So all of the things that the e-commerce ecosystem allows, and there are about 10 offers of the various financial institutions available. From the user's perspective, this information should have taken 5 days to research. Now it's available in 5 minutes. So the Indian consumer firstly loves the fact that they've come this far. And when they want to proceed, right, we actually integrate full service in the back end with the financial institution. So for example, when they start filling in the data, we're able to do a number of verifications on them, which is required for financial underwriting. So for example, mobile phone is verified using the one-time password. There's an integration with PAN. We offer the facility to submit eKYC online. So we're integrated with Aadhaar. A person, for example, starts typing their work email, and we know that Tata Consulting has at tcs.com. So an email with a secret link is sent to that approved corporate email ID, which needs to be clicked on for us to validate the person works in that company. It serves as a substitute for office CPV. PAN is checked. We also have a process in which documents can be submitted online in an optional fashion. So one of the more popular features, right, and this runs on a very secure engine, is that users can submit electronically their net banking statements by giving us one-time access in a secure engine to their net banking credentials. Now, the system encrypts the data in motion and in rest and underwrites the entire 6 months bank statement. So this serves both as a proof of income and a proof of address. And these documents need not be collected in the offline mode. Essentially, after the process, right, a provisional approval letter is provided. And this end-to-end process took 5 minutes. So we can pause this presentation now. Now, what's happening, right? We're breaking down the last vestiges of the paper-based process. So if you look at this process, right, what's not done here but what's live on the site today is you can submit your eKYC online. So we have the Aadhaar integration. So your proof of identity, proof of address, proof of age, they happen fully electronically on the Aadhaar system using OTP. We're integrated with eSign. So today we provide the facility that if you want to sign an agreement, you can digitally sign it. So that facility is being used by financial providers today. The extent of the innovation is such that in India today on BankBazaar, you can get full sanction on a product in 30 minutes. So I'm not talking about provisional sanction, but if you do the automated income, the automated eKYC, and the automated eSign, in 30 minutes, a full sanction with the product being set up is available today in the banking system. In insurance, obviously, they're ahead of all of these processes. So paperless insurance policies are being issued for the last several quarters. And the next step for us, right, is can we deliver the financial product without any paper at all? Is there a 100% paperless solution? Now, our firm belief, right, is that when paperless goes live, essentially the smartphone will be the mode of consumption of any financial product. And by doing that, right, essentially we'll cut risk, we'll cut fraud, because the traditional data clearly points to that, and we'll be able to democratize finance. So the vision as we see it is your mobile phone, anywhere in India, any financial product, in a seamless fashion, in a very easy to use graphical interface, you will consume in paperless fashion. And because of the innovation being driven by the financial companies, the insurance companies, the banks in India, we see this vision becoming reality in less than a year even at this stage. So I think that's the presentation I had. Thank you so much for your time. Would be happy to answer if there are any questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Adil Chetty. The next topic is design thinking for frugal innovation. I request Mr. Amit Shah, President and Country Head of Yes Bank, to come onto the stage. The last topic for the event Smartech BFSI is technology in BFSI sector, the changing paradigm. I request Mr. Gururaj Rao, VP and CIO of Mahindra and Mahindra Financial Services Group, to come onto the stage.